I entered the profession against my will, and I said it is a parasitic profession and all that. But you know, the legend of the profession is something which is fascinating. You know, you hear of great trials, great cross-examination, great lawyers. You know, it's a dream. It's your dream to fight for liberty. It's such a fascinating, very romantic subject. But then I never thought that my boon will be granted with such plenty.
Welcome to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice and Human Rights. It is now a decade since Kannabiran passed on. He was a man, take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again. That was Hamlet. Kannabiran was a self-taught and self-made man. In a profession where godfathers and family and class meant everything, he rose from humble beginnings to legendary heights through sheer dedication and hard work. A prolific reader, he devoured every piece of literature that came his way as he struggled through school, college, and practice. It was precisely that reading which expanded his mind. What forged him into a legend was a sensitive and brilliant defense of political dissidents and revolutionaries who were hunted down by the state during the emergency. He converted the courtroom into a literary convention, often asking his clients to recite poetry or explain the philosophy for which they were charged to the judge. He prided himself on his radical interpretation of the law, often educating the judges before whom he appeared to interpret the spirit and intent of the Constitution. He was admired and loved for his fearless defense of causes, coupled with a deep tenderness for his poorer clients, which made him a much loved figure in Andhra Pradesh. He inspired many young lawyers searching for some meaning and radical dimensions in the practice of law. As president of the Andhra Pradesh Civil Liberties Committee and the People's Union of Civil Liberties, he was critical to expanding these movements to powerful institutions of human rights defense. He was involved in human rights work across the country, which was idolized and adored, particularly in his home state, Andhra Pradesh, by the poor and disempowered and often resented by rich and powerful people unless they had a case or a cause they needed him to fight. It is now a decade since his death, and given the state of human rights today, his presence is sorely missed. This is an effort to preserve his heritage for the bright young lawyers who are emerging today, a generation that he sincerely believed would restore decency, dignity, and justice to our country. Thank you.
The family of K.G. Kannabiran welcomes you to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice, and Human Rights. 10 years after his death, we remember his spirit, his resistance, and his constitutional insurgencies in courts and through courts and tribunals, in defense of dissent, personal liberty, associational freedoms, and justice, speaking truth to power, calling for judicial accountability and state accountability, especially in the matter of repressive laws, custodial violence, and extrajudicial murders, encounter killings, calling out entrenched practices of discrimination and structural violence, and setting out the basic structures of constitutional rule. We bring together a few of the lawyers and judges who knew him personally and worked with him on cases, campaigns, and tribunals to remember their collaborations with him and reflect on future pathways of this important slice of the history of lawyering for human rights and civil liberties, rooted in the Indian experience. K.G. Kannabiran lived and worked in Andhra Pradesh, in Hyderabad. He traveled across the country, appearing in courts of trial and high courts and in people's tribunals and fact-finding missions. from Kashmir, Assam and Manipur to Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh to Gujarat to Punjab, Karnataka and beyond. Within Andhra, every nook and corner, every forest and town bear his footprints. Practically every court in every jurisdiction in the state bears his imprint. Every university, meeting hall, meeting ground has heard him speak untiringly on the meanings of the rule of law and the constitution. No place was out of bounds in his quest for justice. We hope to remember him through the futures of his work and through the work of those who carry it forward in so many different ways. In this specific segment of lectures, we bring together the voices of those who shared his calling. Nithya Ramakrishnan is a lawyer based in New Delhi. She has appeared in courts of different jurisdictions in cases of terror trials, torture, extrajudicial killing, and the rights of prisoners, among others. Consistent in her interrogation of impunity and her commitment to human rights and the rule of law, Nithya Ramakrishnan has long been associated with movements of civil liberties and democratic rights in the country through the PUCL and PUDR, among others. She is well known for her appearance in the Parliament attack case and for her appearance in the Encounters case in the AP High Court in 2009. Her 2013 book, In Custody, Law, Impunity and Prisoner Abuse in South Asia, traces the evolution, practice and politics of custodial abuse and justice in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka and Afghanistan.
With a ready chuckle and somewhat wistful eyes, K.G. Kannabiran was a legend when I started practice. My collaboration with him was in just one case, the Parliament attack trial. The other case in which both he and I appeared was the APCLC encounter case heard by a 5-judge bench of the AP High Court. But that can scarcely be called a collaboration because Kanna was frankly disapproving of outsiders like me coming to Hyderabad to argue the matter. By contrast, I had no manner of doubt that an outsider like Kanna should be invited to Delhi to conduct Shaukat Guru's defense in the Parliament attack case. 4 people were put on trial in that case: Afzal Guru, Shaukat Guru, Jilani, and Afshan Guru, Shaukat's wife. I had been asked to appear for Afshan Guru. Reviewing the evidence, it seemed to me that Shaukat was key to break the case of conspiracy. Kanna's remarkable advocacy in terror and waging war cases, both at the trial and the appellate stages, made me feel that he would set a tone to the defense. He did, in fact, set a high tone of integrity and ability to the defense, and the trial judge, S.N. Dhingra, did display great respect and affection for Kanna. I think our Dhingra likes me, Kanna once chuckled to me. You would pronounce the name Dhingra with the short I, as South Indians tend to. It's hard to say whether Kanna was a criminal lawyer come to human rights or a human rights lawyer come to criminal law. On the whole, I think it was the second. Kanna would insist on the most basic things, which many may consider trivial or may not even know of. For instance, applications or petitions by persons in custody need not be stamped. Kanna would insist that they should not be stamped. The insistence was as much to remind the judge, the lawyers, and the system of how great a deprivation imprisonment was, under what immense handicaps a person in custody conducts a defense. The other useful thing we learned from Kanna was to study the applications for remand carefully. During investigation, when the police seeks custody or seeks a police remand, it is meant to substantiate that request with reasons, with a report of the investigation. So these applications, remand notes, Karna would call them, are not only an index of the progress of investigation, but they are often material on the basis of which subsequent claims of recoveries or disclosures can be contradicted. So you tell me in Tamil, the remand notes are vechche kesa murchulla. Kanna was also very particular about creating record. In this Parliament attack trial, for instance, it was on his insistence that questions disallowed by the judge, we had asked the sanctioning authority, the sanction both POTA and waging war, conspiracy, all these offenses need a prior executive sanction before it can be prosecuted. So we had asked the sanctioning authority whether he was aware of the distinction between waging war under the penal code and terror offenses under POTA. The judge disallowed the questions. It was on Kanna's insistence that we put the questions on record, and therefore the fact that the judge had disallowed these also came on record. Although the issue did not serve to vitiate the sanction, it did serve in other very important ways. The eventual distinction drawn by the Supreme Court between acts of violence against the state, insurrections, terror offenses, and waging war against the state, the basis for that came from the original questions and the distinctions drawn by Kanna at the trial, and also his insistence that we put our queries on this distinction on record. Kanna did not believe in having written questions before cross-examination. They impede the flow, he would say. Questions should flow freely, and if you have them written beforehand, they will impede the flow. For my part, I need to prepare questions, several sets of questions beforehand. And although I may not use those questions, even to extemporize, I need that kind of preparation, but Kanna would have none of it. So early in the morning of the case, he would come to my office. He would have the sheet, the police statement of the witness expected to take the stand that day in his hand, and peer into those sheets as if to internalize the substance. No doubt to have the questions flow freely when he started cross-examination. Do you know that you have magisterial duties while recording a confession? Kanna asked the deputy commissioner of police who claimed to have recorded Shaukat Guru's confession. POTA, as you may know, permitted as evidence statements made, confessions made to police officers, which law otherwise does not permit in this country. So the poor officer, I don't think he comprehended Kanna's question. So he mumbled something like, I have powers under Section 32, POTA. It was in Kanna's cross-examination of this officer, I think, that this officer admitted that he had given barely 10 to 15 minutes reflection time to the accused, Shaukat and Afzal, before recording their confession. This admission was the single most important factor in the Supreme Court eventually ruling both these confessions out of reckoning. It was an immense thing. In the first POTA trial, the case which became the justification for passing POTA into law, in that case, the Supreme Court threw both the confessions out of reckoning. And one of the most important reasons for doing that was inadequate reflection time. Kanna's cross-examination on the point of identification by public witnesses of the accused was also superb. Shaukat Guru's landlord doggedly insisted that he saw the five intruders who were eventually killed in Parliament House, called in the judgment often dead terrorists. Shaukat's landlord insisted that he had seen these men visit Shaukat's house. So, from the prosecution's point of view, this was important evidence to implicate Shaukat in the conspiracy, to show contact between him and these dead men. It was Kanna's cross-examination which exposed the man to be a complete liar, because that landlord could not recognize other people, describe even as other tenants. So this dubious identification to implicate Shaukat was disbelieved both by the High Court and by the Supreme Court, and went a long way towards securing Shaukat's eventual acquittal of terror charges. Khanna, of course, did not want to touch electronic evidence. He said, so he left the cross-examination on laptops and electronic evidence to me. We had the first strategy we agreed upon as soon as Khanna came to Delhi just before the trial began was that on the very first day, we will ask for exclusion of wiretapped evidence. Porter had a whole code on wiretapping and the stipulation that evidence, wiretapped evidence taken contrary to these provisions would be inadmissible. In fact, such taps should be destroyed. The special cells wiretaps in this case, claimed wiretaps in this case, were not at all compliant with the law. So we moved and we said this should be ruled out. There again, Khanna was a human rights lawyer. His arguments were based on the right to privacy, the POCL judgment, and so on. And I took another route. I argued on the fruits of the poison tree basis, the Baldev Singh basis, that the seizure itself being illegal and there being a specified mode prescribed by the law for this evidence. All other modes are necessarily forbidden, so this should be ruled out. And Khanna and I had greatly enjoyed disagreeing about various approaches, etc. In the event, the trial judge disallowed our application. He showed equal disinterest in the various differing points of view that Khanna and I had enjoyed disagreeing about. And we did not succeed there. But we did succeed at the even at the intermediary stage in the High Court. Khanna did not appear in the High Court on this, but he told me, you will succeed in the High Court. But I mean, don't be mistaken. Don't think that it's because of any great faith he had in me. His reason for saying that I would succeed in the High Court was that the High Court judge who was to hear this had been an earlier colleague of the trial court judge, but the man had now been, he had reached the High Court earlier. So Khanna said he will never, never uphold his erstwhile colleague's order, so you will succeed. We did succeed, but I would like to believe that it was advocacy that did it. Khanna's reading of literature and history was extensive. He brought this to bear to the case at hand. His anecdotes the judge would listen to very eagerly. He would have given us short shrift. We were youngsters. But Khanna he would listen to with great interest. So in his final arguments, Khanna referred to the Reichstag fire. He spoke of larger principles. His arguments were a mosaic. They were a combination of democratic ideals and criminal jurisprudence, incidents from history. I remember at one point of time, he argued that attack upon a building, even if that building was the Parliament House building, did not amount to waging war. His written submissions, as I recollect, quoted from Liversedge versus Anderson. See, the point of, it's not as though they immediately yielded results. As it happened, the trial judge ruled against everybody except Afshan Guru, whom he convicted of a lesser offense and gave a lesser penalty. Otherwise, he handed out 3 death sentences. But I think what Khanna was trying to do was to bring a broader perspective in which to locate a particular case on trial. And even if it did not yield immediate results in this case, I have no doubt that it had a salutary effect of leavening the judge generally. In the High Court and the Supreme Court, Shanti Bhushan's effort on Shaukat's behalf were meticulous, heroic, brilliant beyond belief. To have had Shaukat acquitted after 2 courts below had not only convicted him of all terror charges but sentenced him to death was no ordinary feat. It was a feat which only Shanti Bhushan could have achieved. But there is no doubt that Khanna had laid the foundation for this success. What was the Parliament attack case? On the 13th of December 2001, five men in an ambassador car managed to enter the inner compound of Parliament House when Parliament was in session. The car was absolutely loaded with explosives. The security guards foiled their bid. No damage was done either to the building or to any of the members of Parliament, but eight security guards died in the process. All the five intruders were killed. The case had a huge impact on the national psyche. There is no denying that. From the person of these dead men at Parliament House, three mobile phones were recovered and five iCards were recovered. These iCards were fake iCards. Obviously, they had some fake names, refer to a fake institute. All of them had one particular mobile phone number as the point of contact. I still remember the number, 9811489429. Examination of their SIM cards, of the mobile phones which were found on them, revealed not only that these phones had been in contact with themselves just that morning during the attack, but they had also that morning and perhaps during the attack been in contact with this number I mentioned, 9811489429. So the special cell immediately got the call records of that number and found that that number in turn had been in touch with two other numbers on that morning during that period. They put those two other numbers and this on surveillance, claimed to have made wiretaps of conversations, which according to them, one of these numbers was in the possession and of Afshan Guru and the other of Jilani. So they say the attack was on the 13th of December. They reached Jilani and Afshan on the 14th of December based on these wiretappings. And upon their interrogation, reached Shaukat and Afzal in Sopor Baramulla on the 15th of December. So by the 15th, four people were in custody. On the 17th, Pota was invoked in the FIR. On the 21st of December, two confessions under Pota were recorded by police officer DCP of Shaukat and Afzal, and their case was that Jilani refused, so they let him go. These two gave a confession voluntarily, and that was the beginning of the case. So the evidence in the case, it was also their case that when they found Shaukat and Afzal in Shaukat's truck, Shaukat used to ply, was a fruit vendor. He would collect fruits from Kashmir and sell them in Delhi. A laptop was recovered, and that laptop contained pictures of these passes I talked about, these iCards, and also a home ministry pass, fake home ministry pass. So you have these wiretaps, you have the CDRs, the phone records, and you have laptop, broadly by way of electronic evidence. Then they had these confessions. Then there was the evidence of identification. They say that in custody, Afzal identified the five dead men, intruders, called the five terrorists, and signed on an identification memo. Then there were disclosures leading to shops from where explosives, mobile phones, vehicles, motorcycles on which Parliament House was surveyed, a car was also bought. So there were disclosures leading to these recoveries, which the police claimed were also showed guilty conduct, mainly on Afzal's part. Then, of course, there was the evidence of landlords of Afzal and Shaukat, and one of them, both of whom claimed that Afzal and Shaukat were seen with these dead men who were identified by their photographs. And I must tell you that those photographs shown to them were photographs of these men after they'd been killed at Parliament House, faces completely mutilated, couldn't make anything out of it. Anyway, this was the identification. Then identification by shop owners who claimed that Afzal had gone, one of them even claimed that Shaukat and his wife had gone to purchase a motorcycle and so on. So these are the broad heads of evidence, electronic evidence, confessions, evidence of identification. there are evidence of recoveries of some explosives, remnants of explosives were recovered from Afzal's house. So on this evidence, and by the operation of the special law of Porter, the trial court convicted and sentenced to death three people, Afzal, Shaukat, and Jilani, and acquitted Afshan Guru of all terror charges, but convicted her of the charge of concealing the design to wage war under Section 123 of the Indian Penal Code, and sentenced her to 5 years. The High Court completely acquitted Jilani and Afshan Guru, but maintained the conviction and the death penalty on Afzal and Shaukat. The Supreme Court, while upholding the acquittals of the High Court, further acquitted Shaukat Guru of all terror charges, and now convicted him of only the design to concealing the design to wage war under Section 123 of the IPC, and imposed a sentence of 10 years, which ended, and he was eventually released. The Parliament attack incident and the case are significant for many, many reasons. One, the incident itself and the case became virtually emblematic of Porter. Before the incident, there was a reluctance of parliamentarians across party lines. There was a reluctance to pass this law after the lapse of Tada, to bring back a law with many of its draconian features, particularly admissibility of confessions to police officers, near impossible bail conditions, some presumptions. All of this led to some hesitation. So Porto was brought as an ordinance in the October of 2001. Then in December 2001, this incident happened, which then was claimed as absolute justification for such a law. Even so, in March 2002, this law could not be passed except in a joint sitting of both houses. Even then, they were not certain that Rajya Sabha would pass that law. So the incident became really synonymous with Porter. It became the reason for Porter, as it were. The case, as I said, the trajectory through the various levels of judicial decision making, the trial court acquitted one, sentenced her to a lower imprisonment, the High Court acquitted two, trial court acquitted her of all terror charges and convicted her of an IPC offense, gave her 5 years, the High Court acquitted two, the Supreme Court acquitted the third and imposed on him, convicted him of the offense which Afshan Guru had earlier been convicted of by the trial court. So this trajectory, you see, a case, as I said, the impact on the national psyche was immense, immense. So the process could easily have been overwhelmed by a nationalist hype. But the trajectory shows that there was both introspection and analysis in the process. Having said that, I would also have to say that the case does reveal blurring and dilution of some other due process norms. The case is a mixed bag, but significant. The case itself touches upon almost all important matters of substantive penal law, of criminal procedure, of the law of evidence, and of the principles of the general law versus the special law. It will remain a reference point, not only in the law relating to terror, but in processes and a mapping of judicial responses and fidelity to human rights principles and due process principles. This case will always remain a reference point. A, because in the face of that kind of hype, it did uphold very, very important principles of due process, particularly on confessions. I'm talking about the Supreme Court, on custodial rights, on the nature of disclosure and discovery. However, there was another side to it where the rigor with which electronic evidence should be appreciated, the mode of preserving electronic evidence, integrity, investigative integrity, some of those standards were diluted. I shall presently attempt to tell you how. The case is also important because despite that assertion of due process to the extent that I have mentioned, and it is no insignificant assertion, subsequent cases have not followed that trend. For instance, the Harain Pandya decision of the Supreme Court or the decision on the attack on the American Center. And I'll presently try and explain what I mean by saying this, but there's no doubt that this case will remain important. I have outlined the evidence, nature of evidence, under some heads. Now, how did the special versus general law play out? The telephone intercepts, which I told you earlier, the Khanna and I had challenged at the trial, and at the intermediary stage, I had succeeded in the High Court. But when the appeal eventually came up before in the High Court, the Supreme Court had by then sent the whole matter of the intercepts back to the High Court. It had set aside the intermediary judgment of the High Court holding them inadmissible and said the High Court will decide it in the appeal. So there are three important aspects of the special versus general law in this case, which I want to point out. One is the process and the other is in the construction of the offense. So there are three aspects. On the 13th of December, there is an FIR, and either by design or by accident, POTA offenses are not included in the FIR. On the 13th and 14th of December, there are supposed wiretaps. POTA has a whole code on wiretaps. They are not followed. But the evidence is maintained and retained from the trial court to the Supreme Court on the logic that since there was no inclusion of POTA charges in POTA sections in the FIR, the special cell was not obliged to follow the rigor of that code. Now, this case, if ever there was a terror attack, this was, could anybody be in doubt that five men enter Parliament House loaded with explosives? The case became the reason for the passage of POTA, the justification for the passage of POTA. But nevertheless, by the simple expedient of omitting those sections in the FIR, the police, the state, the prosecution manages to evade the rigors of that one code, which is meant for the safeguard of the accused. On the other hand, on the 17th of December, by invoking POTA, they justify police confessions. So this duplicity of having the special law, but choosing to invoke it when it suits the prosecution and evading its rigors when it comes to the protections that it envisages for the accused, this duplicity, unfortunately, the judicial decision-making process did not condemn. The other important aspect is on the substantive penal provision, is relating to the substantive penal provision. Now, Section 3 of POTA defined a terrorist act. Section 3.1 defined the terrorist act. Section 3.2 was the penal provision. Section 3.3 dealt with conspiracy, abetment, preparation, and the whole everything, the whole caboodle, other than the actual commission of the act. So 3.1 defined a terrorist act as an act of violence done with a certain intent by the use of specified weaponry with a consequence of death or destruction. So these three elements are essential for a terrorist act. There has to be presence at the spot. An act has to be done. It has to be done with a certain intent. It has to be done by the use of certain specified weaponry with the consequential damage. That's when it becomes a terrorist act. And if death is caused, then under 3.2, even the punishment of the death sentence can be imposed. So in that sense, it's a complete code. It takes into account murder. Correct? So you have a special law dealing with killing of a certain kind, destruction of a certain kind, injuries of a certain kind, done with a certain intent, with the use of a certain mode on the spot. Independently, it punishes conspiracy, abetment, preparation, and everything else towards that act under 3.3 with a maximum of life imprisonment. So the argument was that those who were not present in the spot and did not do that act as envisaged, even if they had given full assistance in the preparation, they could not be convicted under 3.1 and 3.2 or punished under 3.2. They could at the most be convicted of conspiracy, preparation, abetment, and everything else. And so the maximum punishment could never be more than what is given under 3.3, which is life imprisonment. The second argument was, because of this, because it's a special law which you brought in for precisely this kind of activity and incidents, you cannot fall back on 302 IPC or even waging war. Because here's a whole court dealing with this situation. So you can't now fall back on 302 IPC to invoke the death penalty. The Supreme Court, while it agreed that 3.2, now not even Afzal, nobody, since they were not special, present on the spot, they could not have been convicted under 3.2, and therefore could a death penalty could not be imposed on them under 3.2, nevertheless fell back on 302 IPC, read with 120B IPC, to say a conspirator can be punished as the actor, and this was murder, and this was waging war, and so the death penalty could be imposed on those two counts, the count of waging war and the count of murder. So look at the way the special law plays out. When it comes to assisting the rhetoric of the state, it has its full play. But when it comes to inbuilt safeguards in the law, and which are very few and far between, for the accused, they can so easily be given a go-by. Having said this about the special versus general, now let me deal with how the other aspects of evidence were dealt with. Confessions. Pota had an improvement over Tada in as much as it did not refer to the use of a confession recorded by a police officer against the co-accused, abettors, conspirators, etc. So both the High Court and the Supreme Court held that in view of this conscious omission, confessions made by A could not be used against B, either under POTA or by recourse to the Evidence Act, Section 30. And this was an excellent and extremely well-reasoned portion of the judgment. The Supreme Court went on to say more. It said where custodial rights are not respected, such as access to a lawyer, access to family members, and the assurance of judicial custody over police custody after making that confession is not present, the confession cannot be relied upon. And the confirmation so-called given by the accused that such a confession was made can also be not relied upon, because the person in whom is lurking the fear of going back to police custody, any ratification of such a confession by this person cannot be trusted. Given that since Tada, we had gotten used to courts just routinely accepting confessions, saying, oh, the police officer says it was voluntary, we accept that it was voluntary. He's gone through the motions, we accept that it's voluntary. Even a man in chains, if he's giving a confession, it does not necessarily mean that it was not voluntary. After that line of judgments, in a case of this dimension, that the Supreme Court so completely and forthrightly ruled out the confessions, it was a remarkable, remarkable achievement and extremely salutary, conducive to human rights, due process, and so on. The Supreme Court also said the tone and tenor of the confession is relevant. For instance, it is difficult to believe that Shaukat would have voluntarily implicated his pregnant wife in his confession. There are so many other aspects to the confessions which do not appear to be likely to have been stated. And this is also important, but just on the principle of non-compliance with D.K. Basu, non-access to a lawyer, not having the assurance that the confession was not read out by the magistrate at the time of confirmation. So fundamentally, invoking Miranda, invoking the trial within trial, which is there in UK jurisprudence, the Supreme Court said, particularly given the reputation of the Indian police. Day after day, there are complaints of torture and so on and so forth. This self-incriminating piece of evidence is unworthy of reliance. The Supreme Court went on to lament that in spite of the record of the Indian police, the kind of complaints of abuses day after day, that law should even think of permitting confessions to police officers is very sad. The Supreme Court noted that even in Kartar Singh, the TADA provision regarding the co-accused was only to be given a secondary status under Section 30, but Nalini, in fact, was per incurium in calling it substantive evidence against the co-accused. All in all, it is a complete indictment of any such provision, the thought behind a provision permitting admissibility of police confessions. And Reed, you know, rights against self-incrimination so strictly that confessions in this first Pota case were thrown out by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court also said that you cannot rely on Section 10 of the Evidence Act. A post-arrest confession cannot be relied upon under Section 10 of the Evidence Act as a statement regarding the conspiracy. So an excellent exposition of the law and an honest exposition of the law, something which takes into account the reality. Unfortunately, subsequent judgments have not followed this at all. Not all of them, very few of them. In the Akshardham case, the Supreme Court followed it, but in the Harin Pandya case, there's hardly even a reference to this principle. So what is it that prevents these principles when they are asserted by the courts in cases of these such a dimension? Why is it that it does not enter the system sufficiently for it to become part of the code? This is something we have to ponder about. Now, identification evidence. There are two aspects of this. One is the identification of Afzal by identification by Afzal of the five dead terrorists in police custody. The law up until now in this country is no statement made by someone in custody is admissible. Section 162 of the CRPC rules it out. If it's confessional, sections 25 and 26 of the Evidence Act rule it out. And this was not a confession recorded by a DCP. This is an identification, and every court held it against Afzal. But evidence of identification, although there's a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court, Ramakrishna Mittanlal, which says anybody saying that he identified somebody, even a witness saying that or a police officer saying that, is hit by 162, unless there is identification in court. Here is it's an accused. Disbelief in voluntariness in a custodial situation is built into all aspects of our criminal jurisprudence. But nevertheless, the Supreme Court said this identification by Afzal, supposedly, of the five dead men shows that he knew them. This is incriminating conduct under Section 8 of the Evidence Act, and it's not a statement under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. But the point is, even conduct under Section 8 of the Evidence Act rules out statements. And what is it but a statement? I identify this man, made by a man in custody and spoken to only by a police officer. So it is not because there were any admissions made by counsel or the amicus at the trial, which many well-meaning people have said. That is not the fact. The fact is that what has been held to be plainly inadmissible in law has been rationalized and ratified as conduct to use that against Afzal. And that is, you know, that is a seriously disconcerting aspect of this judgment. On identification by public persons of the accused, as I said, the identification by Shaukat's landlord was disbelieved. The identification by other shopkeepers to whom Afzal is supposed to have pointed out, inasmuch as they corroborated the fact after Afzal in his disclosure or pointing out took the police to those shops and they said, yes, he has come. The Supreme Court said that it could be relied upon. Now, how safe is it to rely on the evidence of a person who may have seen you for a fleeting, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 7 or 8 months later, there can be several views about it. So as it turned out, public identification of Afzal was believed broadly. Identification by the landlord of Shaukat's interaction with the dead men, the terrorist, was not believed, as I said, because the landlord was not able to identify or describe anybody else. And just to identify from photographs saying these men had come to his house, court did not believe. This is now disclosure and discovery. The trial court adopted a very specious argument, which the prosecution continued to espouse in the High Court and the Supreme Court, but fortunately both the High Court and the Supreme Court would have none of it. The next, under the Evidence Act, no statement made to a police officer by a person in custody can be pressed into evidence unless there is a discovery based on such a disclosure under Section 27 of the Indian Evidence Act. By and large, it is believed that this should relate to a material object perceivable by the senses, and it should be a consequence of such a disclosure. But an extraordinary argument was set up by the prosecution, which had its basis in a very specious logic adopted by the trial court, that accused A makes a disclosure statement referring to a certain fact. Accused B refers to it in his confession. Now that is subsequent confirmation of the statement of accused A. So they call this the principle of subsequent ratification. Fortunately, both the High Court and the Supreme Court said no. They went back to an early Privy Council decision of Sukhan in 1929. And that discussion of the law is very lucid, both in the High Court and the Supreme Court. And that it has to broadly refer to a material object perceivable by the senses. A pure mental fact cannot be discovered, but in any case, it has to be consequent discovery, not subsequent. It can't be the accident that something is recorded in A statement, something else is recorded in B statement, both by the police, and B statement now is subsequent ratification of A statement. This cannot be accepted. Now, so the end of all this was that on a very, very detailed analysis of the law of conspiracy, going back to Kehar Singh, the mere knowledge is not sufficient. The fact that there was not enough against Shaukat to show that he was in touch with those dead men. And the fact that he was moving around with Afzal is perfectly explainable by Afzal being his cousin. The Supreme Court went back to the traditional and the careful position on conspiracy to acquit Shaukat of all charges other than that of concealing the design to wage war. And that is how Shaukat was acquitted. But the fact remains that on electronic evidence, for instance, this laptop was recovered from the truck, according to them. The laptop was just left like that in the police station. Some shopkeeper down the road from the special cell was called to say what is there in this. He does not maintain a full record. The cross-examination shows that he did not take the basic precautions even. Then the laptop shows an access on a date 1 month after all these people are sent to judicial custody. While it is supposed to be lying locked up in the police malkhana, there is access. All this is pointed out, and the court says, well, there may be some explanation. So this unwillingness to check the most mutable and vulnerable and changeable nature of evidence, namely electronic evidence, is also another disquieting feature, because virtually even today, this country does not have a code on how to access electronic evidence, how to seize electronic evidence, how to preserve electronic evidence, how to ensure that there is integrity in what you later bring to a court. We don't have a code on it still. Of course, the Supreme Court's acceptance and overlooking the fact that there was no certification under Section 65B, that law has been overruled now. But the unwillingness to deal with the reality of electronic evidence, how easy it is to change it, why there should be integrity in preservation, That, unfortunately, the Supreme Court did not go into. So in sum, I would say that this case will remain important as a reference point from the point of view of human rights, from due process norms, of the judicial dynamics dealing with a case with a huge nationalist hype, but nevertheless retaining fidelity to certain principles, which is, you know, quite remarkable, particularly in throwing out of the confessions, but nevertheless hesitating to go into some other areas as if not wanting to castigate the prosecution for its job in such an important case is one aspect of the matter. It's a mixed bag. But the more disquieting aspect, I think, is even those safeguards which were maintained by the Supreme Court in this case have not, you know, become principles that courts follow as a matter of rule. As I said, in the American Center attack cases, the Supreme Court, for instance, the distinction, I must come back to this, that original question that Khanna had asked about the distinction between waging war under the IPC and terror under POTA. So the Supreme Court dealt with it right from Mir Hasan Khan or even earlier, 1951. Where a colonial judge, of course in 1951, but there were still English judges saying, it is not enough that the police commits mutiny, a section of the police commits mutiny and takes over the armory. With what intent? Unless the intent was thereafter to acquire state power, we will not call this waging war. All those principles were looked at and a distinction was drawn between acts of violence, which may be against the state, which may also be public in purpose, but are not necessarily acts of terror. Then acts of terror. But not all acts of terror are acts of waging war. Waging war would need that intent to deal with state power, acquire state power. But they said in this case, because the highest symbol of sovereignty, namely parliament, was attacked, therefore in this particular case, it was waging war. But these distinctions have not been brought to bear in subsequent case, important cases like the attack on the American Center, where two men on a motorcycle were supposed to have killed the guards outside. It is not even comparable. But without question, it was accepted as waging war. So what is it that prevents, what is the dynamic that prevents this from entering our jurisprudence in a firm way is something for all of us to ponder about. And in this course of pondering and in this course, in our challenges that we face, we miss Khanna greatly. Thank you.